1 Timothy chapter 6 verses 11 to 16. But thou, O man of God, flee these things, and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. Fight the good fight of faith. Lay hold on eternal life, whereunto thou art also called, and hast professed a good profession before many witnesses. I charge thee in the sight of God, who quickeneth all things, and before Christ Jesus, who before Pontius Pilate witnessed a good confession, that thou keep this commandment without spot, unrebukable, unto the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which in his times he shall shew, who is the blessed and only potentate, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who only hath immortality, dwelling in the light which no man can approach unto, who no man has seen nor can see, to whom be honor and power everlasting. Amen.
The four marks of a man of God, as outlined for us in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verses 9 through to 16. Paul outlines four marks of a man of God. Firstly, what you must understand is that he calls Timothy a man of God. Greetings to you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. On this day, the 570th since we entered into lockdown. We currently locked down one. So, O man of God is what Paul calls Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 9. It's a distinguished title. It's a title on four occasions which is used in the Old Testament. It's used for Moses, for instance, in Deuteronomy chapter 33, verse 1. Moses is called a man of God. It's also used in 1 Samuel 9, verse 6, as a title for Samuel, O man of God. It's used again for us in 1 Kings chapter 17, 18, and Elijah is likened to a man of God. And then on the fourth occasion in the Old Testament, when O man of God is used, is it in Nehemiah chapter 12, verse 24, and it's speaking about David. And these four characters, biblical characters for us, are in the scriptures, and they are called men of God, O man of God, the great lawgiver, the great priest, the great prophet, and the great king. And here you have Paul associating Timothy, a humble and meek, righteous, godly pastor, that Paul is assimilating with such a band of godly men, in the same breath, esteeming them in the same company. And here we have Timothy likened as a man of God. And then he outlines four marks, four distinguishable marks, four distinctive marks that are important for Timothy for two causes. And that is the first reason for Timothy to be successful, so to speak, in the ministry. For Timothy to be successful in the ministry, he needs to maintain these four things, these four distinguishable marks, these four characteristics. That's first and foremost. Secondly, for him to maintain the testimony of a man of God, he needs to adhere to these four admonitions that Paul is going to give Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 9 to 16. And the first admonition that Paul tells Timothy is in verse 9, and it is the word flee. There'll be times as Christians, whether you're in the ministry or whether you're not, just as a Christian, there'll be times when you'll have to flee. It's told us simply, flee fornication. We need to flee immorality. We need to flee idolatry. We need to come out of her, my people. Be not partakers of her sins, of her uncleanness. Anything that resembles sin, that's unclean, ungodly, we need to flee. It tells us that Joseph was in Potiphar's house on occasion when Potiphar's wife came onto him. And he left his cloak, his tunic, and he fled. There's a time we need to flee. Christians need to wake up and they need to know what they need to cling to, what they need to cleave to, and what they need to flee. There's certain Christians that are caught up in things that they shouldn't be caught up with. It's time you need to flee. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9, it says, "The unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God." And it gives examples and outlines. You cannot do unrighteous acts. You need to flee immoral things, idolatrous things. David's life was in danger at the time of King Saul, and he had to flee King Saul's kingdom. He sought refuge at a time with the Philistines, but there was a time when he had to flee. You need to times in your Christian life, as you go through the times and the seasons for God, and he has every purpose under heaven for you, that will come a time where he'll test you to see whether you're going to flee what you ought to flee. You can't continue with sin and to entertain sin and to accept sin and to be comfortable around sin and sinners. You may have to flee people. You may have to flee things. But there's going to be a time in your life as a Christian that you're going to have to flee. And he says to Timothy, he says, flee in verse 6. In verse 9 of chapter 6. Flee. You've got to know what to flee. The second instruction, the second admonition that he gives Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 9 is, once you know what to flee, then flee from, then you need to know what to follow after. And the second instruction that he gives Timothy is, you need to know what to follow. If you're going to flee, you're going to need to know where to go. And he gives six things that he instructs Timothy to follow. He says, follow after righteousness. Now, as I mentioned in 1 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 9, it says, for the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Here we've got, the righteous shall inherit the kingdom of God. So if you want to inherit the kingdom of God and the things of God, you need to follow after righteousness. It also tells them that not only are they to follow after righteousness, but they will also follow after godliness and after faith and love and meekness and also patience. Those six things. We need to follow after godliness. 1 Timothy chapter 3, 16, it says, great is the mystery of godliness. God was manifest in the flesh, justified in the spirit, seen of angels, preached unto the Gentiles, believed on in the world, received up into glory. And if it happened to God, as Paul is instructing Timothy here, so it's an instruction to us. And if those things happen to God in 1 Timothy chapter 3 verse 16, so it's instruction to us. Because not only God was manifest in the flesh, but like we see here with the body of Christ, is that we are also manifest in the flesh. The church, the body of Christ today, is manifest in the flesh. Justified in the Spirit. Justified by the Holy Spirit. Seen of angels. Preached unto the Gentiles. Our ministry is unto the Gentiles. Acts 28:28, on the third occasion, Paul said to the Jews, I'm going to the Gentiles to take the message of the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ, the death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ unto the Gentiles. It was believed on in the world. And the last one we're waiting for, the sixth one of 1 Timothy chapter 3:16, which will be received up into glory, which will be fulfilled at 1 Thessalonians 4:16, when Christ himself shall descend from heaven with a shout, with the voice of the archangel and the trumpet of God. The dead in Christ shall rise first, and then we which are alive and remain shall be caught up together in the clouds, and there shall we meet the Lord in the air to fulfill that we will be received up into glory. But only those that follow after righteousness, after godliness, after faith. The Bible tells us in faith, Hebrews 11, verse 6. Now, without faith, it's impossible to please God. And those that come to him must believe that he is, and he is a rewarder to them that diligently seek him. He is a rewarder. So those that are waiting to be received up into glory, he's a rewarder to those that are waiting to be received up into glory. So we need to follow after those things. You need to know what to flee, and you need to know what to follow. But too many Christians are following the wrong things, and they're not fleeing what they should flee. The next admonition, the third instruction that he gives, the distinction of a mark of a man of God, to be called a man of God, to maintain your testimony, your witness as a man of God. Not only do you flee from, follow after, but you've got to fight for. You got to fight. He tells us here in 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 12, he says, fight the good fight of faith. 1 Timothy chapter 6 verse 10, I beg your pardon. 12. Fight the good fight of faith. And then, as you know, in 2 Timothy chapter 4 verse 7, he says, I have fought the fight. I finished my course. I've kept the faith. Too many Christians fall short. They disband. They don't finish the race set before them. Some translation says, I've run the race. 1 Corinthians chapter 9:24. I've mentioned some of these scriptures recently. It says, know ye not that we which run, run all, but only one receives the prize. Therefore run that you may obtain. We need to finish the course. We need to run the race. We need to run that we will obtain. We will get a crown. But not a crown of a wreath, of a temporal crown. But he's talking about, wherefore there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness. Follow after righteousness, because there's a crown of righteousness laid up for you. And Paul, as we see here, him esteeming Timothy in the same company as this great lawgiver, great priest, great prophet, and great king, the great Timothy. So Paul is admonishing us, you and me, and he's saying to us, that if we lay hold on eternal life, as the scripture tells us in verse 12, it says, because there is laid up for us a crown of righteousness. Paul goes on and he says, whom the righteous judge shall give me, but not me only, not Paul only, but also them that love his appearing. If you love and longing for his appearing, if you follow after godliness, he was believed on in the world, he was received up into glory, you'll be received up into glory. We shall meet the Lord in the air. 1 Thessalonians 4:17. There'll be laid up for us a crown of righteousness. We'll receive a crown, not Paul only, but ourselves too can be esteemed and associated in this company, in this band, to be called men of God, men and women of God. In the same band of merry men where Timothy is, Paul is saying to us, I'm going to receive a crown of righteousness, but there's nothing stopping you guys from receiving it. It's not me only, but those also that are looking for the return of the Lord Jesus Christ. They're loving His appearing. Titus chapter 2, 13. The blessed hope and glorious appearing of our great God and Savior Jesus Christ. Those that are looking for His appearing, that they'll be meeting Him in the air. So that He can look to you and say, well done, good and faithful servant. You need to fight. We learned last week about and the week before about an athlete. The athlete needs to fight. He needs to finish. He needs to tuck in. He doesn't give up at the first hurdle. It tells us to endure hardships, endure afflictions, endure hardships as a soldier, as a good soldier. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 4. No man that warreth entangleth himself with the affairs of this life, but pleases him who has called him to be a soldier. And the Lord is a rewarder to them that diligently seek Him. But if you come, you must believe that He is. For without faith, it's impossible to please God. Hebrews 11, 6. We've got to fight the good fight of faith. We've got to believe. We've got to push through the barriers. We've got to get over the hurdles. You can't give up at the first stumbling block. If you feeble or stumble, you're not going to finish the race. You're going to fall behind at the back of the pack. And the Amalekites, like they did on a previous Bible teaching I taught you, they came, and as they were going through the wilderness, fleeing the Egyptians, following God, following the cloud, and the pillar of fire at night, and the cloud by the day, following after things of God, following after and hungering after and thirsting after righteousness of God. But the Amalekites would come as they were exiting Egypt and going through the wilderness, and those stragglers that fell behind the Amalekites would come and they would kill them. They would take them out. Don't fall behind the pack. We've been through lockdown after lockdown and wave after wave. Don't fall behind, because you're going to be taken out. Satan's going around like a roaring lion to see who can defy it. You're going to have to fight with the high praise of God in your mouth and a two-edged sword in your hand. Let the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, the psalmist tells us. Psalm 19, verse 14. O Lord, thou wilt show me the pathway of life. In your presence is fullness of joy. At thy right hand are pleasures forevermore. Psalm 16, 11. We need to fight. We need to flee. We need to follow. And we need to fight. And the last mark, distinction, that Paul gives Timothy. Not only have to flee from to be a man of God. Not only do you have to follow after to be a man of God. Not only have to fight to be a man of God. But you've got to be faithful. Faithful. You've got to be faithful in your walk with the Lord, walking the straight and narrow. When there are people either side of you stumbling, 1,000 might fall on our left side and 10,000 on our right. Psalm 91. You've got to walk the straight and narrow so that you can finish the fights. You can be in the cloud, the Spirit leading you by day, the pillar of fire by night. Be faithful. Be faithful in the things that you do for God in ministry. Be faithful. Finish the race. Too many people fall short of the glory of God. We need to finish. Paul's personalized. He said, I have finished my course. The course that God had set Paul on to do. Amongst all the perils of his life. And the shipwrecks and the beatings and the whippings. And being stoned on one occasion. He said, amongst all those things, I finished my course. Can you say that you're going to finish your course? That you're going to fight the good fight? That you're going to keep the faith? You're not going to lose heart? Be faithful in your marriage. Be faithful in your relationships, in your workplace. Be faithful. You, O man of God, may be the closest people get to Jesus Christ. You might be the shining example in the workplace. Or wherever you find yourself doing your daily chores, you might be the closest that somebody is interacting with you, might be the closest they're ever going to get to Jesus Christ. You might be the closest that they'll understand righteousness and faith and why you flee ungodly things. So do not err concerning the truth, but know that, as Paul spoke to Timothy and gave him these four admonitions, these four distinguishing characteristics, these four marks, and saying, Timothy, O man of God, 1 Timothy chapter 6, verse 11, O man of God, to maintain your testimony, your witness, they overcame you by the blood of the Lamb and the word of their testimony. Too many people today, their testimony is growing broken down. Satan's coming after you, either as a dragon or a serpent who wants to break down your destiny, that you haven't got a word. You haven't got a word in season, out of season. You're not instant. You don't reprove, rebuke, nor exhort, because yourself in need of exhortation and yourself in need of rebuke. O man of God, can you be esteemed in this company? Can somebody call you a man of God without sounding funny? Four marks. These four things, if you want to be successful in your ministry, if you want to be successful in your marriage, if you want to be successful in your workplace, if you want to be successful with the things that God has given you, because you want to please Him who has called you to be a soldier, you want to please Him. And you want to believe because you know He's a rewarder of those that diligently seek Him. He's shown you the pathway of life. In His presence is fullness of joy. At His right hand are pleasures evermore. If you want to be successful, you need to do these four things. And if you want to maintain your integrity, to be called in such company as Moses, the great lawgiver, Samuel, the great priest, Elijah, the great prophet, David, the great king, Paul, the great apostle, and Timothy, the great pastor. If you are to be called great in the eyes of God, then hold yourself accountable to be called a man or woman of God. Thank you. And
when you're weary, feeling small, when tears are in your eyes, I will dry them all. I'm on your side. Oh, when times get rough and friends just can't be found, like a bridge troubled water, I would lay me down like a bridge over troubled water. I would lay me down. when you're down and out, when you're on the street.